Thank you very much for the kind introduction. Thank you. I'm delighted to be here. I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me. I'm truly delighted to take part in this conference. So, we are going to talk about sparse modeling of data. This is a very wide field with a lot of results. And what I'll do first is to give you the general story of this field, which will be the sort of introduction of my talk. And then we will go into the novelty, things that took place in the past 1 or 2 years. We'll talk about convolutional sparse coding, and we'll talk about multi-layer convolutional sparse coding. And this might sound boring to you, but let me tell you, this is nothing but boring, because it's going to take us all the way from sparsity-based models all the way to deep learning. So we are going to give birth to deep learning emerging from sparsity-based models. This is the main message. There is a second message in my talk, and the second message has to do with the fact that these three are in fact generative models. And being generative models, it means that we can use them to design algorithms, yes, but we can do far more than that. We can analyze theoretically the performance of those algorithms. And so I have to emphasize, this talk is theoretically oriented, as I'm trying to show you the connection to deep learning and the generative models and the capabilities of being analyzed. So let's start. At the end of the talk, we will be talking, we will be presenting the multi-layer convolutional sparse modeling. So this is the running title, and what I'll do now is to parse it into words, and I'll explain it one word at a time. And so I'm starting with the term modeling. What do I mean by modeling? All of you, all of us, are processing information. This is what we do. Now, these sources of information are quite diverse. They are different from each other, but they do have something in common. All of them, each in its own way, has structure. Now think about it. What we do in signal processing, image processing, computer vision, machine learning, is all about identifying this structure and exploiting it. This is what we do. Let me give you an example. Suppose that I'm measuring the signal of some sort. And I have this accumulated information, and here is what I know, and that's all I know. Suppose that I know that this signal is contaminated by white additive Gaussian noise. I know that the noise is white, I know that the mean is zero, the standard deviation of the noise is one. To be fair, I know so much. Can I remove the noise from this signal based on the information I've just given you? The answer should be negative. No, you cannot do this. Why? Because in order to take a signal and separate it into a signal and noise, you have to tell me something about both ingredients. I kept telling you about the noise, I said nothing about the signal. So you cannot give noise. But what if an expert comes and says, your signal underneath the noise, it tends to behave like a piecewise constant signal. Okay? Then I can do something. I can ask, what is the simplest piecewise constant signal that is closest to the measurements, such that the residual behaves like the noise? You can formulate it in all sorts of ways, and many of them will make sense. And you know what? You could recover the clean signal. So what happened here? We have assumed a model. We have imposed a model on our unknown, and only because of that, we were able to denoise. This is something we do in signal image processing all the time. All the time. And not just for denoise. Whenever I say model, I mean mathematical description of the structure that I believe, it's a belief, I believe exists in my signal. Okay? So these are the models we'll be talking about. In image processing, you see here a partial list of models or things closely related to models, and there are many of them. And they are central in everything we do. Whenever you bring in a new model to the game, you have always this tension between the desire to make the model simple, so that algorithms relying on it will be simple, and the desire to make it reliable to the data. I can always suggest a model that says, you know what, your signal is zero. This is a terrific model in terms of the simplicity. But of course it's useless. I need to do justice to the data. And so this tension exists between these two forces all the time. One last comment about models. They're always wrong. Models are never correct. It's all about finding the model that is more flexible and having less mistakes, less errors. But keep in mind, models are wrong by definition. Here's another example. You're all familiar with the JPEG algorithm, compression by factor 10, 20, with terrific results. Why? Because it relies on a model. It relies on the model that says, I believe that patches, 8x8 patches, taken from natural images, are expected to behave in a very particular way. If you apply the DCT, then you expect to get concentration of the energy in the top left corner. And so you can take the top left corner, throw the rest, and you get the essence of JPEG. Now, will this model work for radar imaging? No, it won't. Why? It's just not suitable for it. You have to adjust the model differently. Mm-hmm. I'm looking at the literature in our field, and I see a pattern of papers. And the pattern goes like this. The author choose a signal of interest. I choose face images. Then the author will choose the model to impose. If I'm working with face images, I might as well use Gaussian mixture model. I have a model. Now define your problem. Your problem, for example, could be missing pixels that you want to recover or maybe compression, something that you want to do with those images. And you combine all this into one mathematical formulation, typically optimization problem of some sort. And what do you get of all this? You get a paper. This is how papers are created. Okay? And what I'm trying to say here is that over the years, what we see is that for the same signal, for the same problem, you keep updating the model, and with these updates of the model, you are improving. This is the story in image denoising, this is the story in image deblurring, this is the story in compression, in super resolution, in practically every problem we're touching. Keeping updating the models, improving them over time, and because of that, getting better and better results. So this talk is about models. And models are everywhere. They are definitely in all the inverse problems, starting from denoising all the way to the more complex things. They are there for compression, anomaly detection, sampling. Whenever you sample a signal and you say that your data is band limited, you are imposing a model. When you do recognition, maybe you don't think about it this way, you are imposing a model because bringing examples is your way of bringing in the model. So models are everywhere. So this talk is about models and specifically about sparse length. The model that is based on sparsity. And we'll talk about sparse length immediately. And then we'll talk about its descendants, special cases of it. And what we will see is that those special cases take us all the way to deep learning. Good. So just to explain to you what is modeling. Now let's talk about what sparse modeling is. Sparse length doesn't come out of thin air. It relies on knowledge that has been accumulated in this community and others. It relies heavily on knowledge in image processing, signal processing, mostly in the context of wavelets. It relies on tools, concepts borrowed from approximation theory. It takes tools from linear algebra, algorithms from optimization. Oops. Okay, I should be careful about this. It takes some concepts from machine learning, mostly in the context of adapting the model to the data. We will be doing this. And it has been taken to a large set of problems and showing terrific results in all of them, typically state of the art. Wonderful. So let's see what this model has to say. And you know what? Just like in the JPEG, in the spirit of JPEG, let's try to say, what is the structure in patches of size 8x8? So here is a patch of size 8x8, and it's not alone, it's a corpus of such patches coming in, and I'm trying to tell you that they are simple. The model always claims your data is much simpler than you think. What this model has to say about patches? Okay, so in order to use the model, you need something called a dictionary. This dictionary basically contains many, many patches of the same size, 8x8. In this case, there are 256 of them. All of them are the dictionary, each one of them is referred to as an atom. Okay, now comes the model assumption. It says, I believe, remember, it's a belief. Models are sort of a religion. I believe that this patch and many others like it could be described as linear combination of only few atoms from the dictionary. You take away the word few and you lose everything. The word few is key here. Why? Because if you have 64 patches from the dictionary that are linearly independent, I can recreate anything from them. So but it means nothing. The point here is that few of them can be merged to create your patch. Let's have a closer look at this. I started with a patch of size 8x8, 64 pixels, and I turned it into a vector of length 256. Why? Because that each atom I have to tell you how much it is in total. So I turn it into a redundant representation. But this vector is mostly zero. Remember, only in this example, for example, only three shoes are large numbers. So this vector is redundant, but
I
have to tell you about this patch of six numbers, because if I tell you who are the atoms involved and how much each of them contributes to the mixture, I give you everything. So six numbers. Lovely dimensionality reduction. The patch is much simpler than it seems. I like to think of this model as sort of chemistry of information. The dictionary here, with all its atoms, reminds me very much of the periodic table, with the fundamental elements. Whenever you bring me a molecule, it is always a combination of only few of the fundamental elements. And just like this case, our signals are believed to be sort of molecules built of only few atoms. So we are generalizing the concept of chemistry to data. Here is a slightly more formal way we start seeing equations as we move on, a formal way to describe sparse. So here is a machine that generates signals. In our case, let's say, generates patches of size 8x8. Inside this box, there is a memory that holds the dictionary. Now, the dictionary is a matrix. Every column in it is an atom. So in our example, for example, this would be 64, and this would be 256. Okay? Every column is an atom. Lovely. Now I press on the button on top to create a signal. When I do that, a sparse vector alpha is created. This vector is of length 256 m in general. It will have only few non-zero. And when d multiplies alpha, I get the linear combination of few atoms, which is x. And so sparse can believe that this is how signals are generated. Sounds crazy, but this is what we believe. And with this we will go. Okay. This model does not come easy. In fact, it comes with such difficulties that at first view, it may look like a dead end. Let me show you the first problem that we encounter. It is called atom decomposition. And it was something very simple. You give me a signal, and I'm supposed to tell you who are the atoms involved in its creation. Okay, so let's have an example. Not this one, a new one. I have 2,000 atoms. And I'm taking this dictionary and I'm going to MATLAB. This is something very simple. And I'm creating the signal based on 15 atoms that I combine. Okay? I come back to you and I'm asking you, here is the signal, here is the dictionary. Find who are the 15 atoms I used. What you will have to do is to go through all the possibilities of choosing 15 atoms out of the 2,000. This is the number of possibilities. If every one of those possibilities will take you 1 nanosecond to check, and this is generous, let me tell you, this is the amount of years it will take you to finish the work. So it seems like you're stuck. How can you work with this model? So just before answering whether we are stuck or not, let's again formulate this, because I will need the notations that come in. So again, the dictionary is this matrix, in our example, 64 by 256, it is multiplying the sparse vector to create the signal, and basically when I give you the signal x and the dictionary d, I'm begging you please solve the linear system. The point is, this is an underdetermined linear system, it has infinitely many possible solutions, but you will go for the sparsest one. So you will have to solve this problem here. L0 norm, this notation here, stands for counting the number of non-zeros in alpha. And so when you see this equation, expression, what it says is the following. Find me the sparsest alpha to explain the linear system. Now typically, we don't get a clean signal X, we get a noisy version of it, and then we move to this noisy version of the problem. So you give me Y, and I'm supposed to find the sparsest alpha to explain Y up to an epsilon L. That's the whole difference. And you know what? These two problems are just NP-hard. They are impossible to solve in general. But we have approximation algorithms. We have relaxation algorithms. We have greedy algorithms. For example, basis pursuit in the relaxation. We have the matching pursuit, or orthogonal matching pursuit, the thresholding. And I'll dedicate one slide to present these three algorithms just to keep you with me on the topic that I'm covering. Okay, so let's talk about the basis pursuit. Remember, the top problem is just impossible to solve. Impossible. What are we doing? Searching for approximations. Basis pursuit, Donohoe, 95, says, you know what? Just replace the L0 with L1. That's it. Replace the L0 with L1. Now, if you do this, immediately your problem is convex, solvable in reasonable time. You can do it in a fraction of a second in MATLAB, depending, of course, on the sizes involved. And that's it. The question is whether it will work. I will talk about it immediately. This is the basis pursuit. The greedy algorithms have a different take on the problem. They are searching for the support, the location of the non-zeros. And so the matching pursuit will do the following. It will say, suppose that I'm giving you a budget of just one atom. Which of the atoms will you choose to do the best in terms of bringing the two sides of the equation closest together? So you sweep over all the atoms and choose the one that gave you the smallest error. Okay, once you find it, stay with it. This atom stays with us. And now ask who wants to join. Again, sweep and try to minimize the distance between the two sides of the equation. There are many ways of doing this, and this is the essence behind greedy methods. If you do orthogonalization after each iteration, you get the OMP. I will be showing you some results on the OMP. The thresholding, and please remember what I'm saying now, it's key, because I'll come back to this. The thresholding algorithm is the dumbest possible pursuit algorithm. Okay? Remember this, I will come back to this statement. And this dumbest algorithm says the following. Take your signal Y, remember we are trying to approximate the solution of the top equation. Take the signal Y, do inner product with all the atoms, basically multiply by D transpose. And threshold, just that, threshold. And that's it, this is your alpha hat. And of course it's a crude way of approximating alpha hat, but hey, this is it, this is the thresholding algorithm. Good. Now, there are many pursuit algorithms, I just described three. Let me show you an example. Remember the example I've shown you about 2,000 atoms and 15 of them that I choose, create a signal and then you have to decipher who they are. The red points in this graph are the true coefficients. So for example, if I'm looking at this one over here, it means that atom number 450 maybe has a coefficient minus 1.6. Okay, these are the true coefficients. Here is what happens when I'm using the basis pursuit. Perfect recovery. And it's not a coincidence. It's not going to work all the time. There are conditions for success. But here is the amazing thing about sparseness. There are theorems that give you theoretical guarantees for the success of pursuit algorithms. Each algorithm with its own guarantees, all depending on the sparsity of the underlying solution and properties of the dictionary. Okay? So let's have a look at one of those results just to give you the flavor of things. In order to do that, I have to define the notion of mutual coherence. It's a property of the dictionary. So here is our dictionary D, and you know what? Let's just assume that the column of it has been L2 normalized. So every column is normalized. Now compute D transpose times D. If you do that, you get the Gram matrix on the right. D transpose D has ones on the main diagonal. In fact, all the elements in this matrix are inner product of different atoms. And so, the main diagonal is ones, and the off diagonals are inner product between different atoms. The coherence is the maximal, the largest off diagonal entry in absolute value. That means, if I tell you that the coherence is 0.1, it means that all the red entries are in the range minus 0.1 to plus 0.1. This is the coherence. And all the results that I will show you today will use the coherence in order to express the message. And if you are familiar with this field, you may have heard of the restricted isometric mobility, the spark, the bubble function, the ELC, and some other animals. All of them are used, can be used, I will not mention them in my talk today. Okay. So, I was about to show you a typical theorem in this field. Let me show you one such theorem. So, think about the story this way. A signal is created from sparseness. This is the machine that generates sparseness signal. That means there exists a sparse alpha that multiplies d, and this is x. Lovely. Now, I'm not getting x, I'm getting y. I'm getting y, the noisy version of it, with noise that is of energy, bounded energy epsilon. What do I have to do? I have to solve this pursuit problem, okay? But I can't. I told you I can't. I cannot solve an L0 problem. It's just NP hard. So what do? I replace it with L1. I replace it with L1, and the question is, will I do good? My question basically is, how far alpha hat is from the original alpha? And the answer is this theorem. Now look at this theorem, and it will come back again and again, because I will show you some theorems today. I'm highlighting the region that you're supposed to read, okay? Don't read the other parts. And so what it says is that if this alpha that created the signal, if this alpha is sparse enough to begin with, this is how sparse it should be. I know that you don't see, so this is how sparse it should be, okay? Then I guarantee you that the basis pursuit leads to a stable result. The alpha hat is not far from the alpha. Now, few insights about this result. First, if there is no noise, then all the right-hand side is zero, and that means that we get that alpha hat equals alpha. We get perfect recovery, just like we saw in the previous example. So it's not a surprise. It does happen from time to time. Secondly, I have to tell you, this is the worst case of analysis. You can get far better bounds if you are willing to relax your statements and make them probabilistic. And indeed, over the years, and I'm talking about an industry of maybe hundreds of papers, coming up with typical theorems like this, covering all sorts of pursuit algorithms, by the way, including the thresholding algorithm, obviously, with more strict conditions of success. Okay, we were running through difficulties with sparse, and here is a second difficulty. I'm working on images. A friend of mine is working on audio signals. A third person is trying to predict the market, and each of us needs his own dictionary. What do we do about it? The answer is learning. This came as a vivid topic of research in the past decade. You have to learn the dictionary. You take examples of signal, and basically you do some sort of reverse engineering to basically find who is the dictionary that best sparsifies your data. KSPD was mentioned here. Yes, this is one typical such algorithm, but there are others, many others. I will not talk too much about it today, but remember, it's always in the background. You cannot do anything without this. Okay. And in the spirit of counting difficulties with this model, maybe the toughest of all is, why should I trust this model? Signals are created from atoms combined linearly. It doesn't sound right. Why should I trust it? Why should I trust it to be universal and treat all sorts of information sources? And you can answer this in two possible directions, which was what was done in the literature. The first is to say, you know what? Let's tie this to existing models, like GMM, for example, or PCA, and explain how we generalize these models, and therefore we are making better than them. We are doing things better than them. The alternative is an empirical proof, sort of proof. Well, you say, you know what, I simply try. I plug it into problems and it just gives me great results. And both have been practiced quite extensively in the literature. And so the bottom line is, many difficulties, but constructive answers. This model is safe, it is working. The activity in this field is huge, with growing number of papers, and there are many books. I'm so surprised to see so many books published on this topic. This is the book I published in 2010. And I thought, you know, it's an esoteric topic. Who knows how many books it will have. All these books are covering this field. All these books. And I'm sure we will see more of them coming on soon. Okay, I have to do some propaganda. I'm creating a massive open online course on Sparseland. It will start on the last week of October, this October, we are working hard on creating it. It's under edX. It is built of two parts, each of them 5 weeks. Join us. It will basically give the story that I gave here much more detailed. Okay. So, you know, when you take Sparse to image processing, there is immediate difficulty. You cannot train a dictionary for the complete images. So what do? You break the image into patches. You break the image into fully overlap patches. You treat the patches themselves. You forget about the image. You think that the patches are your signal. You impose your model on them, and then you pile them back. And so underneath this stands some sort of an assumption, a model assumption that says, I believe that natural images are such that every patch in them has a sparse representation with respect to some local dictionary. Okay? Now this raises some difficulties because patches are just the means. I don't care about patches, I want the image. I need to tell you what is the model for the image, not the patches. And this started us thinking, what's going on? And it brought us to the convolutional sparse coding. So this is a model that says each patch has a sparse representation with respect to a local dictionary. I will come back to this in 3, 4, 5 minutes. Okay, so from now on, I'm moving from the background to the recent result that we have. And all these results are the fruit of the joint work with my PhD students, Yaniv Romano, Vanda Papian, and Jeremiah Sulam. Yaniv is starting his postdoc at Stanford University working with Emmanuel Candes. Vardan is finishing his PhD and starting his postdoc with David Donahoe. So they found terrific places to proceed with the research. Okay, so so we talked about sparse modeling and now we are going to the convolutional sparse modeling. And this is a special case of sparseness and it goes like this. I believe that images, this is an image, and here it is X. I believe that it can be written as a sum of convolutions. These convolutions are built of filters, small filters. You can think about them as filters of size 7x7. How many of them? In this case, 16, in general, M filters. And every one of those local filters will be convolved with a sparse image. These maps are of the same size as the image. Okay? This is convolutional sparse modeling. Here is another way of looking at the very same model, the way that will accompany us, matrix form. It goes like this. Now X here, this X here, is no longer an image, it's a vector. I'm thinking about it as a vector. And it is the sum of matrices CI multiplying vectors gamma I. Who are those matrices? Very simple. If this is your filter, by the way, I have moved to 1D convolutions just to make things simple. So if this is a small filter, this is the convolution matrix corresponding to it. I'm thinking about it as circulant because I don't want to mess with boundary issues. And it is banded, circulant and banded. Circulant because I'm doing convolution and banded because there is a narrow filter applying everywhere. And this CI is multiplying gamma I, and those gamma I's are obviously the very same gamma I's we saw before, simply stretched to become one more filter. Okay. Now, if this is true, I can write it again. I can concatenate all those CIs into one big matrix, and I can concatenate all those gamma I's into one long vector. What do I get? I get that I believe that my signal X is a matrix, a dictionary, times a sparse vector. It's a special case of sparse. Why special case? Because D now has a very special structure. It's not just anything. It has a structure. Here is how it looks in the case of three such filters, okay? Now, typically we don't like this organization. We prefer another organization where we take the first columns of each, put them together, then the second, then the third, etc. So we get this sliding block structure where every one of those blocks is the very same small matrix. Let's call it DL, and its size is N by N. M, the number of columns, is the number of filters, and N, the number of rows, is the length of the filters. Good. Now, why are we looking at CSC? Because of the following reason. It is the general model, it speaks in terms of the global image X believed to be d this d times a sparse vector gamma. But let's now look at a patch in this relationship. When I'm going to location I and I'm cutting out a patch of length n, this is the operator ri multiplying x. Basically, it is all this long stripe multiplying the vector gamma. But of course, this long stripe contains many zeros. So the part that is really doing the work is this part. The rest just doesn't exist. And this part multiplies this part. So let's have names for this. Let's call this stripe dictionary, and this is the stripe vector. And so what I'm saying to you is that the patch in location I, Rix, equals a small dictionary, omega, times a small vector, gamma I, that is a portion of the big gamma, and it is sparse. Okay. Now, as I move to one pixel down, look, I'm moving one pixel down. I have to move n elements in my matrix, and I'm meeting whom? I'm meeting omega all over again. It's the very same omega multiplying another sparse vector, gamma I plus 1. Now, gamma I and gamma I plus 1 are overlapping. I simply shifted n elements down. Gamma I plus 1 is sparse as well. So the patch Ri plus 1 times x equals the very same omega with another sparse vector. So what did we get here? We got the very same model assumption we kept using without really understanding anything. Every patch has a sparse representation with respect to a local dictionary, but now this is part of the global model and not just talking locality. Okay, the first thing that came to our mind is, okay, if CSC is so good, let's check what theory has to say about it. Why aren't we seeing theorems specifically tailored for the CSC model? Maybe it is because the existing theorems are strong enough and cover the needs? Well, we tried. Remember, I've shown you this theorem that says that if alpha, if gamma, in this relationship, if gamma is sparse enough, then Bayes' pursuit is successful. Let's see how strong this claim is. You know, there is a lovely result by Welsh that gives bounds on the possible coherences. And it says, for matrices of the form we are looking at, convolution dictionaries. And so what we see here is that for two filters, just two filters, the more, the worse you get. So two filters, and every one of them is of length 64, the best coherence you can get is this, 0.063. Now, this means that if you plug it into this expression of the bound, you get that I'm allowing you four non-zeros in all gamma. So gamma is huge. If your image is 1,000 by 1,000, that means 1 million pixels, then gamma will be 1 million times the number of filters, let's say 10, so 10 million. In those 10 million, you allow me four non-zeros, and only then guarantee success. I have nothing. We are stuck. So clearly the existing theory for sparse length doesn't really contribute anything to the knowledge of CSC. And so we decided to fix this, and these were the first results we had a year ago. And what we did is to be faithful to what we understand about patches. Now, coming back to patches, I told you every patch is expected to have a sparse representation. Who are the sparse representation of the patches? Those are those gamma i's. Gamma I plus 1, all these gamma i's. So rather than talking about sparsity of the global gamma, let's talk about local sparsity. Here is a new measure of sparsity. Don't be afraid of notations. This L0 infinity norm in sliding windows basically says the following. Run over all those gamma i's and check which of them is the densest, containing the most number of non-zeros. This is your measure. So if, for example, it is 4, it means that in all the gamma i's, I never found more than 4 non-zeros. Okay. With this measure, we come back and redefine our problem, and we find out that it is just as tough, impossible to solve, and we will be interested in approximating it as before. By the way, when I'm interested in finding the locally sparse solution that explains why, up to an epsilon level, it makes a lot of sense, because this measure being small means what? It means that every one of the gamma i's is sparse. if every one of the gamma i's is sparse, it means that every patch gets a sparse representation, just as I keep assuming, so it makes sense. So what we did next was to generalize the whole theory of sparseness to this notion of sparsity. And what I'll do now is to show you just two theorems, two results, to give you a taste of the things we did. The first has to do with the OMP. Remember, OMP is this greedy, crazy method that accumulates the number, the locations of the non-zero one by one. Now, remember one thing. OMP never heard of local sparsity. It doesn't care. OMP is a global algorithm, and yet we are employing it to approximate the problem we have defined. Will it work? The answer is yes. There is a theorem that says that if those gamma, if this gamma is locally sparse, this is how locally sparse it should be, then OMP does terrifically well. It finds exactly the location of the non-zeros. Okay? Small comment here. This ingredient in this inequality is the energy of the noise in a patch, the maximum noise in the patch. And the beauty about this result is that with a local condition of the sparsity on the gamma i's, I guarantee global optimality. Now, how many non-zeros will I allow now in the complete gamma? A lot, because I'm basically forcing you. Let's imagine that this number here is 4. Suppose that this is 4. It really means that in the sliding window, I never meet more than 4 non-zeros. But altogether, it could be order of n non-zeros. So, way, way more dense than what we had in the regular theory. So we have a much, much stronger result now. And if we said something about the OMP, let me show you the basis pursuit. This is the basis pursuit. I've shown you the basis pursuit where there was a constraint, and now this is a Lagrangian form. This is the typical approach used by many. What you see here is a list of papers using this form in recent years for applications without any mathematical foundations. So, here is a theorem that says, you know what? Everything they did is safe, and here is why. If gamma is locally sparse, now the condition is much simpler. If gamma is locally sparse, then basis pursuit performs very well, and these are the details. It recovers the dominant coefficients, it gives you a small error, everything as wished. So, yes, basis pursuit operates very well. Aha, you see here the word skip? Let's skip. I'll skip this. I will say one word about the three slides that I'm skipping. You will find them in my webpage. The message in them is the following. Okay, I'll exploit the time to tell you what I was about to show you and did not. We showed you just now that there is a theorem that guarantees success of pursuit algorithm, global success of pursuit algorithm, based on a local condition. But we wanted far more than that. We asked whether we could suggest an algorithm to solve the global problem, an algorithm that works on patches. So here is the dream. Imagine an algorithm that breaks patches from the image, works on them locally, does all sorts of aggregations, and claims global optimality. And these are the three slides. It leads exactly to this. So, in fact, this is exactly the part that refers to dictionary learning in the CSC, the new result that we have, but I'm not going to talk about it. Okay. So far we talked about the CSC, and now let's move to the multi-layer version of it. Little bit of motivation. Convolutional neural networks, now this is the time to wake up. This is the main story, okay? Wake up. Convolutional neural networks and convolutional sparse coding have some things in common. Wow, this is frightening. They use convolutions, they train on data. They use non-linearity that sparsifies. Red U is some sort of sparsification effect. But of course, these are all hand-waving. Can we do it more profoundly? Can we connect the two more profoundly? And the answer is yes, we will do that. And this is where I'm going. Okay, so let's first recall how a neural network is working. Very fundamental. Here is your image that you feed into a network, and you convolve it. You do this convolution, and then you take whatever came out, and you threshold using gradient. Okay? You get an activation. You repeat this several times for several different filters, and you get this tensor. You take this tensor and repeat the operation. But now your filter will be 3D, like this. And if it moves from one location to another, it will skip M1 samples because there are M1 filters. So I'm filtering, thresholding, repeating, and so on and so forth. What is missing in my skin? Pulling. We will not talk about pulling. Stride. Stride is the way of saying subsampling. Yes, you could fit here subsampling quite easily. No loss of generality. And you know what? When it comes to the linear part, the linear operation will take us from the input image to the first tensor. Let's call it W1. This is the set of filters operating on the data. The linear part taking us from the second, from the first tensor to the second, let's call it W2. Good. So, mathematically speaking, here is what we did. We took the signal Y, the image, we multiplied it by a set of filters. This is exactly a set of convolutions reorganizing the samples. This is W1 transpose. Then we added the threshold, the bias vector, and threshold, the value. We took whatever came out of this, applied yet another set of filters, and added the bias and threshold it. There are many details on the slide, I'm not going to cover all of them. This is the relation between the input and the output for a two-layer network. The parameters, obviously, are the W's and the B's. Good. Now let's come back to our reality. Remember, I believe that signals are created as a sparse combination of atoms from such a dictionary. This is the CSC. I still believe in it. But now I will add another ingredient to this model. I will tell you, you know what, this gamma 1, which is a sparse vector representing x, is itself a signal. And being a signal, it has a CSC model for itself. So here it is. I think that gamma 1 can be described as a set of filters multiplying gamma 2, another sparse vector. And these are two layers in a multi-layer convolutional sparse coding. And of course you can take it to as many layers as you want. Little bit of insight about this model. This model is still a CSC in the sense that x equals d1 times gamma 1. But now gamma 1 cannot be anything. I'm imposing a structure on gamma 1. What is the structure? I'm telling you gamma 1. It is actually d2 gamma 2. Now obviously you immediately see the connection that says that x equals d1 times d2 times gamma 2. Or you know what, if you have k layers, then you can compute the multiplication of all the dictionaries and get that x equals the effective dictionary, all the layers combined together, multiplying the very last layer. And so what am I showing you here? This is a special case of sparse land. A dictionary multiplying a sparse vector equals a signal. So yes, I'm suggesting a very special kind of sparse land with much more structure than usual. Why? Because of two things. First, observe that it's not just gamma k that leads to this sparse. Gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, all the gammas all the way in should be sparse. This is a demand of this model. And maybe a better way to explain this is the following. Look at the case of d1 times d2. Who are the effective atoms? The effective atoms in B1 are just atoms, you know, small atoms, small filters. When I multiply D1 by D2, I'm basically, let's take, for example, all D1 and multiply by the first column of D2. This will create the first atom in the combined dictionary. And what is it? It's a combination of few atoms from D1. So all I'm saying is that as you multiply D1 by D2, you combine atoms to molecules. And now my super atoms, if you like, are no longer just atoms, they are molecules. And if I have D3, then I'm combining these molecules to become cells. And then D4 will make them tissue, and D5 body parts. And so the dictionary will accumulate and create super and super atoms. And if all this sounds vague to you, here is something I'm doing by jumping to the end. We have learned the dictionary of MNIST, for example. These are the filters in D1, and they are boring. They are just edge detectors. Nobody cares about them. Now, I cannot show you D2. D2 is nothing to look at. But D1 times D2, these are the atoms. They are no longer simple atoms. They have also elongated edges. When I show you D1 times D2 times D3, these are the atoms. And as you can see, they're already getting complete digits. Okay? I'll come back to this example. Here is the same story. Oops, I skipped it. I'm sorry. I had a very similar dictionary for C4. I guess due to lack of time, I'm skipping it. Okay. So now let's define the pursuit problem. Remember, there is a model assumption. I believe that signals are behaving along the lines I've just described. So the pursuit problem would be, you give me a signal X, and I'm supposed to find the gammas. Who are the gammas? Of course, in asking this question, I'm supposed to know the dictionaries. Who are the gammas? Now, typically, as I told before, you never get a clean signal, you get a noisy signal. So you will be getting Y, and you will be asking what is gamma 1, gamma 2, all the way to gamma k, to explain your signal so that it is epsilon away from the model. How do we solve this problem? We will talk about this. This is the pursuit problem. Okay? And I'm jumping again to the end, and I'm coming back to the MNIST example. Remember, we had these three dictionaries? Look at this example. This is the signal Y, and this is the signal X that is epsilon away from Y, and this X can be written as D1 times gamma 1. And here is gamma 1. You have to accumulate many, many small atoms to create your digit. And still, this vector is very sparse. Well, the very same X can be written as D1 times D2 times gamma 2. Well, this is now gamma 2. Now you accumulate molecules, and so with few of them, you can get the very same image. And look at this vector here. I don't know if you see this, but there are only, yes, you see it. There are only 5 atoms to choose. 5 elements in the combined dictionary, D1, D2, D3, and you get the complete recovery of the very same image. So in our model, if you give me this signal Y, I'm supposed to provide you gamma 1, gamma 2, and gamma 3 that will obey these equations. How can we do that? Okay, I'm coming back to something I told you almost an hour ago. Thresholding is the dumbest pursuit algorithm. Okay, it is also the simplest. Let's try to build on it. Let's take the thresholding algorithm that says, you know what, if your signal Y is a noisy version of a dictionary times a sparse vector, then this is your best way of getting, not best way, possible way of getting gamma hat. Okay. And what do you do about the thresholding? You have the freedom to use half thresholding in blue. You have the ability to use the red curve that is known as soft thresholding. You can even do one-sided thresholding value. Now, I don't know why people in machine learning chose value. Why the one-sided? It doesn't make any sense. In sparseness, for example, we know that one-sided thresholding makes sense only if you expect the location of the non-zeros to be positive. Why should you believe that? Anyway, these are the options we have. So, in the spirit of trying to find something simple to do, let's do pursuit of this problem using the thresholding algorithm. We'll go for the first equation, we'll take the signal Y, and multiply it by D1 transpose and threshold. And we'll get an estimate of what? Of gamma 1. We'll get an estimate of gamma 1. Now, gamma 1 itself is a signal. If you multiply by D2 transpose and threshold, you get gamma 2 hat, and so on and so forth. Now, look at these two relationships. This is coming from our layer thresholding. This is coming from the feedforward neural networks. It's the same. So, given the model assumption that we had, and given the decision to run the dumbest pursuit ever, we get the feedforward neural network. So, whenever we are using feedforward neural network, we are actually running the pursuit algorithm under this model assumption. Now, this is not the message. Here is the main message. You see, here is a machine that I believe explains how signals are created. These equations hold for the signals that are generated. Now, if you give me a noisy version of this signal, and then you're asking me who are the gammas, I can run a pursuit algorithm, yes, sure. But I can do far more than that. I can ask questions like, under what conditions am I successful? Under what conditions those gamma I hats will align with those gammas? Nobody in deep learning ever dared asking these questions of this sort. We can. Okay, so let's ask these questions. Let's ask specifically about the hard layer thresholding. When are you successful? Under what terms? What are your pitfalls? How can we improve you? We will talk about this briefly, and I'm finishing in less than 10 minutes. We will not talk about how to train, the question that was here. We are definitely busy working on this, and we have some ideas, but I will not talk about this. And I will not talk about maybe the hottest thing to do. Can you explain all those tricks in deep learning? Can you explain batch normalization? Can you explain pooling, dropout, the architecture that people are suggesting? Can you explain all this? And we are building the answers to this. So we have partial results, which will not be discussed here. So success of the layer closure learning, I'm going to throw it to a theorem. Again, don't be alarmed. Here it is. Only the highlight region. And it says the following. If those gamma i's, all those gamma i's, are locally sparse, this is how locally sparse they should be, then the layered Hall thresholding finds the correct support. It finds exactly the location of all the non-zeros. This is a terrific result. Okay? So, local conditions on sparsity of the gamma i's, and by the way, activations in actual neural networks are sparse. Local activations, and you get guarantee for success of this dumb algorithm. Now, there are a few problems with this algorithm. The first of which is the contrast. You see this ratio here? It's really annoying. And this is really a shortcoming of the thresholding algorithm. If you have many non-zeros, and we have small ones and large ones, the contrast between them will haunt you. So what do you do? What people in deep learning do? They do batch normalization, by the way, because of this. So they know of this problem. Okay, so this is one difficulty. Second difficulty is the error growth. You don't see it immediately, but this equation basically suggests that as you go deeper into the network, you increase your error, which is a feature of the way we have built the algorithm. And another problem is that even if there is no error in the data, you will still make errors in the thresholding. So this is a trouble with thresholding algorithm. So can we do better? Of course we can. We are coming from Sparseland. I told you we are familiar with far better pursuit algorithms. So let's suggest layered basis pursuit. Layered basis pursuit will do this. It will estimate gamma 1 using the L2, L1. And once it finishes, it will have an estimate of gamma 1. It will plug it into another basis pursuit and so on. This is the layered basis pursuit. We were so excited about it. We thought, wow, this is great. So we have something new to tell to the community of deep learning. Not really. Apparently, in 2010, a paper suggested the very same concept under the name deconvolutional neural networks. Without any connection to deep learning, to sparsity, without any understanding of models, this is just something they tried, and it seems to work far better, and they suggested it. So this is a struggle we have. These people doing deep learning are quite talented. Competing with them will be tough, but coming up with a theoretical background, I'm sure we will surpass them. Okay, so here is a theorem for the basis pursuit, and basically all it says is, if those gamma i's are sparse enough, then basis pursuit is doing terrifically well, and remember the problems we had? Contrast is no longer an issue. You don't care about contrast. If there is no error in the data, there is no error in the estimation, you get perfect recovery, and there is still the error growth, which we saw in another paper that we released 2 weeks ago to Elad. So, this is where we're standing. And just one last message, and this might align well with things you have seen. Suppose that I have a multi-layer convolutional sparse coding model of 10 layers. That means that I have to solve 10 basis pursuits, okay? So I have to run this 10 times, 10 basis pursuits. Now how do you solve basis pursuit? One appealing algorithm that has been developed in 2005 is known as ISTA, Iterative Thresholding Algorithm. And basically, this is the equation that you have to apply. Observe that you have to take the current estimate, compute the residual, project back, add, and threshold. And you just do it again and again, and you solve this. So suppose that every one of those basis pursuit you do for 50 iterations. You serve them by applying 50 iterations of ISTA. So here is what you have to do. This is the inner loop and this is the outer loop. 50 iterations for the first basis pursuit, 50 iterations for the second, etc. How many altogether? 500 iterations. You have a network of depth 500. If you're wondering why deep learning is so deep, it is because of that. 500 steps to do what? To write 10 basis for suits, that's what we do. And the architecture that I'm pointing to here is in fact known as recurrent neural network. So here is a way to explain an existing architecture using our own terminology. By the way, there is a small change here that people in deep learning did not notice. When we do these 50 iterations for one basis per suit, the parameters of all the nodes should be the same. As you move to the second, the parameters should be the same. They are not doing this, they are just training everything like crazy, assuming that they have infinitely many amounts of examples to train on. So, time to summarize. I started with sparseland, the general story of sparsity, and when it comes to treating images, we moved to the convolutional sparse coding concept, and we brought in new theory for it. Then we moved to the multi-layer version, and this multi-layer version, with its theory, seems to be totally connected to the practice of deep learning. So it gives new foundations to deep learning. I told you that there are two messages in my talk. Here they are. All these three, sparseland, CSC, and the multi-layer, they are all generative models. If you have a generative model, you can design algorithms, and I've done that, but you can also analyze them theoretically, and we have done that as well. So this is one message. Obviously, the second and the main message is new foundations for deep learning. Maybe we can use them to understand better what we do, and maybe to design the next generation deep learning. So maybe it's time to bring back deep learning to this community. I think I'm done. Thank you very much. I'm not sure we have Anthony.
Thank you for the very interesting talk so far. I understand that the talk is mostly about the theoretical advances for this new framing. I was wondering whether you're aware of some of the successes in these applications, sort of more on the practical side. What type of problems it has been tried out and shown success?
Okay, so I have not shown you the main result yet. When it comes, it will basically show you that a similar model to the one that we have just discussed will be leading to architectures. I will be defining a model. I will create a pursuit algorithm to solve for the gammas, for the representations. And you will look at this algorithm, you will see that these are deep learning architectures. All over again, deep learning architectures with one major difference. We can claim theoretical, we can make theoretical statements. We can tell you, for example, when it is likely to succeed or not. And this will expose all sorts of things. This is a theoretical statement. It has no immediate applications. What we are doing now with my students is to seek all sorts of avenues to explain or to get better results because of the insights we have coming from the modeling point of view. And we have some initial such results, and I chose not to talk about them today because I want to emphasize the story of how you can explain theoretically deep learning using sparsity tools. Thank you for your question. Any other question? Yep.
Hi, Michael. I have a question here. I'm Paul Nippon from University of Missouri. And can you tell us a little bit about relationship between sparseland and frame theory that is very popular in mathematics?
Right. So when I mentioned that sparseland has background, one of the fields we are relying on is frame theory. Frame theory basically generalizes the concept of transforms to become redundant, and you would not believe the richness as you go to this option, the richness in terms of theory that you can develop. But we changed one major thing as we created sparsity. We brought in sparsity. And sparsity is key. Sparsity does not exist in frames. In fact, frames are tying themselves, maybe unnecessarily so, to L2 as a measure of goodness of the representation. Maybe because they are trying to get some sort of robustness against noise or something of this sort. We are saying, no, L2 is wrong. We are moving to L0 or L1. And with this, everything starts to fly. And these are the results that we got. Sparsity is key. Yeah.
Are you making any inherent assumptions about the images or signals? You know, their statistical properties.
It's there in the model that we assume. When I impose sparse length on images, then basically I believe that there is a dictionary underlying and I have to find it. But there is also statistics over the location of the non-zeros. I didn't give you all these details, it's nasty and I don't have time. But of course, the location of the non-zeros, the connection between the non-zeros, and there are some connections. All sorts of these are squished into the model as a statistical model of what? Of the representation. Now, a simple representation gives birth to an image.
So you said that your sparse method theory can give some theoretical underpinnings to deep learning.
It's coming up. It's exactly the part that I'm going to describe, yes.
Okay. Well, my question would be that will this also learn to more efficient training algorithms for deep learning?
Terrific question. Not yet, but we are thinking about it. And in fact, in the slides I skipped, there is a hint to this. I will mention something about it as they are setting up. What I'm going to show you immediately is the multi-layer CSC, basically CSC repeated several times. If we know how to train one good CSC, then we can borrow it to train many CSCs. We developed such algorithms. So we are very hopeful to find a new algorithm that will replace backpropagation, that will train on patches and do local things, very natural things that we do in sparsity, like nothing, like KSVD and local pursuit, and succeed. And yes, we hope to get there.
Do you have time for questions?
I think
you did it. Ask them for the sessions or the coffee. The next will be, yeah. So, as we already inserted the question, part of the question into the pod, so we have no time to continue. But if you have questions, you can ask after that. So I just started the last step. I just print a gift to the excellent talk for the Professor Elad from our organizing committee.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. This is the end of this talk, and the following program will be in the third floor. All the oral